Hello my friends and welcome again to my video channel. Today we will start a new project. You see here the famous Drake Sea Line, known since decades as one of the best lines ever built for the amateur radio market and still very good today. My intention is to add a digital frequency display for the receiver R4C and the transmitter T4XC. And no, I do not want to swap these analog scales by a digital display. Some guys are doing this, I've seen it in the net. When I've seen this, I thought I'd get stomach ache. Never swap these analog scales. They are famous, they are extremely good, very precise in the range of 1 kHz or better when calibrated to the nearest 25 kHz point, and they are part of this radio. Deleting them and swapping them by a digital display is a sort of sacrilege, or more worse. I want to add an external display which can be set on top of the radio, of the receiver and the transmitter. These modules are available in the market, you know, these cheap modules you can buy, they are going up to 65 megahertz, or I think there's a new version available up to 100 megahertz. Doesn't matter, six digits in the range of 8 or 10 euros, dollars and so on. They are very good. My idea is to build a small case and then they are on the top of the, for example, of the receiver, and then we can read the frequency here and here. By the way, I swapped the original incandescent bulbs by LEDs and new blue foil. They faded out over the decades. This will be part of the project. I have done this modification with an R4C some years ago. Meanwhile, I sold this R4C together with the counter, of course. And this is my own C-line, and I will do this job again. This is a picture of the idea. This was my R4C. I sold it some months ago. That's the external display here on top of the receiver. It shows the same frequency. Okay, here we have an offset of some kilohertz. The error is in the crystal. The band crystal is not absolutely correct. I need to realign the scale here, but I don't do it. Digital display here. It's a small case. Color is blue, of course. And the connection is on the rear side. There is a connector. I replaced the original one. It's this famous 4-pin connector. I replaced it by a DIN plug, 8 pins, and connected a cable to the counter unit. In this cable, there's also the power supply, the injection frequency from the premixer comes out. So the counter here is fully supplied with power and all information from the R4C here. That's a project. I have to install in the R4C a new jack here, connect in the place of the old one. Also have to add a buffer amplifier to get out the injection signal without any influences on the receiver itself, to get out the DC supply and install here on top the counter module in a small case. This is a schematic for the R4C, for the output of the injection frequency in the R4C. I will install a simple emitter follower, BF199 or so. It's not necessary to use a FET here because the impedance of the injection signal here is rather low. We can take it from the injection connector directly or from the first transformer, which goes to the premixer or comes from the premixer, doesn't matter. We can connect it here. It's an emitter follower supplied by 12 volt DC stabilized internal, and it goes to the connector on the rear side. I will use a DIN connector, 8 pole. Especially for the counter module, I need the plus 15 volt non-stabilized. This is pin 2 and this is connected. This is an external counter. I have a separate voltage stabilization for 12 volts for the module. which is fed with 12 volt. This is a cable between the R4C and the counter. This 12 volt AC is not needed. I just connected to the pin 3 for any further use. Also, the internal stabilized 12 volt DC is also not used. Maybe I don't connect them, I will see. I only need the 15 volt DC non-stabilized. That's the advantage, that the counter here is decoupled from the internal power supplies. I have a separate voltage stabilization, so the supply voltage here, which is always a little bit dirty, caused by the module, by the digital counter module, is filtered and it is blocked. So this wire to the pin 2 here is clean, filtered properly, and again it goes to the 15 volt DC, and the internal 12 volt DC is also stabilized, so all the dirt, digital dirt here on the wire disappears in the 15 volt DC. That's what I will do. So I have to install this simple buffer amplifier. Again, it's only an impedance converter, it's not an amplifier, it's an emitter follower. And of course, for the external counter, I need a case and a separate construction. This is a mechanical solution for the counter module externally. It's a small case. I will show you the type in the next footage. Here we see the module. This case is the absolute minimum size. I had some problems to get it in. The side here, the side panels are a little bit too big, or the module is a little bit too big. I had to file away the corners here. This is a power supply, voltage stabilizer, and the three caps here. What you can see here, this is a pin plug on the rear side. It's an 8-pin plug. I used here also a blue foil. It's a plexiglass with a blue foil. So the blue LEDs here are looking very good. That's the solution. I will close it and then focus on this circuit here. I want to give you a hint for this module here. This is a power supply, a DC power supply. On this side, that's okay. Red is plus, black is minus or ground. But the input, the frequency input here, where the HF is connected, red is ground and black is the signal. These pins are wrong soldered. I don't know whether it's valid for all of these modules, but please check before you install them that the polarity here is correct. Maybe you'll find some surprise. Again, in my case, this red here is ground, and I had to connect this red wire here to this pin, and this pin is the center pin, which is ground. And the black one, this is the HF signal. This goes to pin 7. This is this one here. It's weird. I don't know whether this is also valid for the newer modules. This module is approximately 4 or 5 years old. I bought it many years ago. But I think when you use it, you should check them to avoid any trouble. You may ask for the type of the case I'm using. This is this type of case, the box. It's an aluminium box. Please note, I do not advertise here anything. I don't get a single cent. I don't want money. I just tell you, or tell those who are asking which type of case you are using. I use this case here. It's up to you whether you buy it, and please don't ask me where you can buy it. It's not so difficult to use a big worldwide web to find a supplier in your region. And here, a little bit bigger, the description of the type. I've used the black anodized one. This is a type, and in the net you can find it. The concept. We have here the block diagram of the R4C. We have here the PTO, it's a permeability tuned oscillator. It's a very linear one, we have seen, with a very good linear scale. Band crystals, premixer. And the result is a frequency which is 5645 kilohertz above the receive frequency. So this frequency here is always above. We have here the first filter, it's a four-pole filter. It can be replaced by better ones. There are options on the market, or these options were on the market. Today it's difficult to get a better filter for this frequency here. IF amplifier, noise blanker. And then we have a mixer or amplifier. In case of AM, first look in onto AM. We have here also an AM filter, again with 5645 kilohertz, same as here. This frequency goes to the third mixer. We have here a crystal oscillator. In case of AM, this filter, this oscillator works on 5595 kilohertz, 50 kilohertz below this frequency. So the IF is generated with 50 kilohertz. It goes to the AM detector and to the loudspeaker here. That was the path for AM. In SSB and CW, it's a little bit different. Again, same path here, 5645 kilohertz. But now we have here this amplifier operating as a mixer, and the 50 kilohertz BFO for the passband tuning is mixed to it. And the filters for SSB CW have a frequency of 5695. So this signal here is converted up by 50 kilohertz. You see here AM at this, but SSB at this frequency, and goes here out. By this BFO, it is mixed 50 kilohertz up. And the third mixer here gets, in case of SSB, a frequency of 5645 kilohertz. That's the SSB frequency here. It's the same frequency as here. And the signal is mixed down. So we have here, again, 50 kilohertz, 5695 minus 5645. These are 50 kilohertz here. And this 50 kilohertz goes to the product detector, the modulator, with the same 50 kilohertz. So these 50 kilohertz first converts the signal up by 50 kilohertz, and then in the product detector it is converted down by 50 kilohertz. So when I change this frequency, I do not change the audio pitch. I only change the relation of this filter related to this frequency here. So it's a horizontal shift of the filter to passband tuning, which is realized here. It's a very straightforward system, a rather simple, but it works very good. We have here two connections, injection, this jack here, and carrier oscillator. Both are needed for transceive operation with the transmitter. There are cables going to the transmitter. Well, what's our concept? We simply have to measure this frequency here, whether we have AM or SSB, subtract this frequency here, and then we have the frequency of reception. In case of AM, we have the center frequency of the AM filter, which has 5645 kilohertz here and here. And in case of SSB, we have here the zero beat frequency, assuming that this crystal oscillator here is correctly aligned to 5645 dot 000 and so on. So this crystal here must be set very precise with this frequency. Then we have here the zero beat when we subtract 5645. What have we to do? Well, it's rather simple. We have to build a small buffer amplifier, feed this signal out to a separate connector, and then we can connect the external frequency counter to this connector and measure this frequency, subtract 5645 kilohertz. These modules I've shown you can be set to a IF. It's no problem. It's very nice, very handy. So we can indicate the receive frequency or the zero beat in case of SSB and CW. Another word to the case. Whatever case you use, please use a metal case. And look that all parts of the case are connected electrically by good screws together, so we have a shielded box. do not use a plastic case. Plastic case is of course easier to work with. But please consider, you have a very sensitive receiver here, strong transmitter, so you should avoid any coupling of harmonics and so on in or out into this or out of this counter, so always use a metal case. Just by the way, you will see when you have a look at this receiver, and if you know the R4C very well, you see that there is a lot of modifications I've made in the last 20, 25 years, 30 years. A new audio amplifier, the old amplifier, original audio amplifier is simply horrible. It's a Class A amplifier with a transformer. It generates more heat than all the tubes inside together. A new power supply with a much better filtering. Here we have an additional input filter for the first IF. It can be switched on with the relays here. It's a CW filter, very narrow. As I remember, it is, let me say, 200? I think 200 hertz, yes. This is a small buffer amplifier for the output of the IF. I have the IF also as output. That's here. I can connect a panorama scope or something like this to it. It's for the first IF in front of this filter, of course. Additionally, I have a new output for the Antivox. The deletion of the original audio amplifier deletes also the Antivox, but we need 150 volt AC or something like this output. So I installed here a stronger amplifier to get a higher output voltage, which still comes out here as the Antivox with a high voltage, which can control the transmitter. Okay, but this is not the topic today. Also some new shieldings, as you see, I've added here. This is also good, the R4C has one weak point. It's a bad shielding inside. The crosstalk over the filters is not the best one. It's it has a rather bad blocking, and signals are bypassing the filters. Minus 40, 50 dB or so only, it's bad. Well, first step is to replace this one. I will take it out and rewire it. And now to the next step. We found we need a small buffer amplifier which produces the output signal of the injection signal. Well, the injection signal is here. This box is this wire which comes or goes to the premixer. This is used, for example, also from the transmitter to inject the injection signal in case of a transceive operation. We need this signal here on this side. Here we have a possible output. This is this old famous or rather strange plug, 4-pin plug. I don't have a plug for it, a connector. I will swap this one and replace it by an 8-pin plug DIN connector. It will fit nearly perfect into this hole here. The screws are a little bit more spaced than this one's, but this can be corrected, and I think the body here will slip into the hole. If not, I can make it a little bit bigger. So the next step will be to remove this connector here, replace it by this one, and then wire it according to the scheme I've shown you in the last footage. And this is the end of part one of the videos about the Drake C-Line and installation of digital frequency counters. I've decided to produce a little bit shorter videos. On the other hand, we will have more videos. The total time will not be less. It's a little bit easier for me to handle them, though. I stop it now. Part 2, 3, maybe four will come as soon as possible. Stay healthy, stay tuned, and see you on this channel.